Yeah, so good afternoon everyone. So today we are going to have the third and the last session on the engineering surveying topics. So today I am going to give an overview of GPS, Global Positioning System, which is a part of Global Navigation Satellite System, that is called as GNSS. So here I am going to give what is GPS and how it calculates the coordinates of a particular location, what are the possible sources of errors, and for what purpose you can use the GPS, all these things, including the history of the GPS development. So before going into GPS, we will discuss about GNSS. What is GNSS? GNSS stands for Global Navigation Satellite System. It is a standard generic term used for satellite navigation systems that provide autonomous geospatial positioning with global coverage. So that means it is a group of satellite systems which gives you the autonomous geospatial positioning across the globe. This term includes GPS, GLONASS, Galileo, BitU, and other regional systems like IRNSS. IRNSS is nothing but Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System. So all this GPS, GLONASS, everything, it's all a group of satellite systems which gives you the positions of various locations which can be useful for navigation purpose. So we are going to discuss a GPS in this lecture. So GPS is a part of GNSS. So what is GPS? GPS is a satellite-based GNSS. As I told that, it is a global navigation satellite system. It is fully operational since 1993. It provides reliable location and time information in all weather and all conditions and anywhere on or near the Earth's surface when and where there is an unobstructed line of sight and four or more GPS satellites. That means it will provide you a location and time information in all weather, in any weather, whether it is rainy, cloudy or anything, so snowy, it will give you the location and time information all times, day or night, anywhere on or near the Earth, provided if there is an unobstructed line of sight to four or more GPS satellites to the receiver. At least four or more satellites should be visible to your receiver point, then you can get the location and time information. So it is created, realized, maintained by United States Department of Defense. Its official name is called as NavStar GPS, Navigation by Satellite Timing and Ranging GPS, Global Positioning System. So colloquially, we call it as GPS. Many people think that GNSS means GPS. GPS is a sub-part of GNSS. Since it is a US-made satellite system, similarly there are Russian-made satellite system, European-made satellite system, China-made and Indian-made satellite systems, which is for the GNSS purpose. So in this course, we are going to discuss exclusively about the GPS, that is NavStar GPS. The working principle, everything remains same for all the GNSS systems launched by various countries. History of GPS. The first one is in 1969, the Defense Navigation Satellite System DNSS was formed. Then in 1973, the NavStar Global Positioning System they developed. Initially in 1978, they have only four satellites. To develop a GNSS, that means Global Navigation Satellite System, one satellite or two satellites is not sufficient. You need number of satellites, more than 10 or more than 12 satellites you need. So that is why many countries could not develop such kind of navigation satellite systems for their purpose. So initially in 1978, the four satellites were launched. Four satellites means you will not get continuous GPS signals across the Earth every time. So that was the limitation initially. Then they slowly increased the number of satellites. In 1993, 24th satellite launched, initial operational capability. 1995, fully operational capability they achieved. That means what happened? You need minimum 24 satellites to cover the entire world 24 hours by 7, 365 days in all weather, in all conditions. In that, so one satellite will not sufficient to give you the latitude longitude. Minimum you need four satellites. Then, so to cover the entire Earth 24 hours by 7 means you need 24 satellites. Some organization, space organization, they might have achieved this by 26 satellites or 23 satellites like this, depend upon the each satellite configuration characteristics. In 1995 onwards, the GPS, the Navstar GPS becomes fully operational with 32 satellites. That 6 satellites are under reserve. In case if anyone gets damaged or weakened, they will put the another satellite into service. What happened? Till 2000, May 2000, all the signals from the GPS is not available to all the civilian purposes outside the USA. After May 2000, the military accuracy data is also provided to the civilian users. Before that, only the very core signals were available to all the users. We will discuss about those things in the subsequent slides. The structure of GPS. So it contains three segments. Space segments, which is all about the satellites and their orbits, all their movements and everything. That is the control segment, the ground station, where they do the monitoring of the satellite orbits, if there is any deviation from that original proposed orbit, they will do some corrections and then they will put the satellite into orbit again. And then the user segment. User segment is the GPS receivers. So as a civil engineers, we are one of the major users of the GPS signals. So in this lecture, we will be mainly focusing about the user segment. How we can identify the or calculate the location of your GPS receiver. We will discuss one by one about the components. If you see here, the current space segments, there are 32 satellite vehicles are available. They are all in 6 orbital planes. So 6 different orbital planes are there. Each is inclined 55 degrees with respect to equator, one orbit. Orbits are separated by 60 degrees. Each orbits are separated by 6 degrees. So 6 orbital planes, so it covers the entire Earth surface, which is of 360 degrees. So the satellites are located approximately 20,200 kilometers above the Earth surface. Orbital period of one satellite, that means one revolution, one round of the Earth, it is approximately 11 hours 55 minutes. You can say 12 hours. So these constellations, the satellite space segment constellations, the orbital planes and everything are configured such that 5 to 8 satellites can be visible from any point on the Earth surface. They have designed the orbital planes such that 5 to 8 satellites will be visible from any point of the Earth, provided there is unobstructed line of sight. There should be any obstructions between the receiver and the satellite. So the simple example is, inside the building, you will not get the satellite signal. Inside the dense forest area, you will not get the satellite signal, because the forest canopy will obstruct the line of sight. Similarly, inside the building cover, the roof will obstruct the line of sight. So it should be an unobstructed line of sight. Then you will get 5 to 8 satellites visible from any point of the Earth's surface. So this graphical illustration shows the GPS constellation. If you see here, there are 6 orbital planes are there. Each are separated by 60 degrees. So this orbital plane and this orbital plane is separated by 60 degrees. And each are 55 degrees inclined to the equator. So that any point of the world, Earth will get 5 to 8 satellites in any point of time. Then we will discuss about the control segments. So the control segment contains one master control station. It is located in Falcon Air Force Base Station, Colorado in USA. And there are 5 monitoring stations, 3 ground antennas and backup control systems also there. So these all 4 systems occupies the entire control ground control segment of the GPS, that is Navstar GPS. You have one master control and 5 monitoring stations across the world and 3 ground antennas and backup control system. We will just see where these are located and what are their functions. So this is the picture where it tells the locations of these different control systems. So Colorado here, is the monitoring station, as well as they have the master control station. And in Hawaii and in Ascension Islands, they have ground antenna. And DGO Garcia in Islands, they have the monitoring station and ground antenna. And somewhere here in this far east, they have the monitoring station and ground antennas. We will see what are the functions of these things. So the maintaining the systems, what happens? This is your satellite here. This is your satellite here. Now, if there is any problems, the errors, all these things, if the satellite is the orbit is deviating from the original orbit, so then what happened? The satellite orbit, if there is any error in the orbits or the clock error, so it will create a new navigation message. All these things will be monitored from the 5 different monitoring stations. Whenever the satellite passes across those areas, it will be monitoring the monitor stations will be monitoring all these informations. Then those informations will be passed on to the Falcon Air Force base station, and then here they will create the, they will correct all the errors and they create a new navigation message, and that will be uploaded to the antennas, and then it will be again transmitted to the satellites. So then the satellites will be repositioned in their original orbit. Then you will get the all the corrected signals. So this is the main purpose of the control stations. How this system works? If you see here, initially there are in space there are 24 plus satellites are there, and from there you will be getting the signals, and those signals will be tracked from across the 5 monitoring stations. Those stations they will track, and if there is any error, it will be passed on to the master station, and from the master station they will correct the errors, and then errors will be transmitted to the satellite, and then the receiver will receive the satellites. So this is what it happens. So if you see here, these monitoring stations, they will monitor it, and in the master control station at the Falcon Air Base, they will do the corrections, and it will be uploaded to the back to the space segment satellites. And when you are the end user, when you are keeping the receiver here, the current ephemeris transmitted to the users will be the corrected signals. We will see what is ephemeris and other details later on. This is how the system works. So we are the end users, where you will be having the GPS receiver, and before that these process are occurring, and still after this process, after the corrections, no, still there will be some errors. So we will discuss about how to identify the errors, and what are the magnitude of the such errors, and how to reduce the magnitude of such errors by some surveying techniques. We will discuss those things also in this lecture. The next is the last segment of the GPS is the user segment. The user segment here, it can comprises of GPS antenna and receiver, which are and the processors for finding the position, velocity and precise timing. So it is mainly used by the aircraft, by the pilots and ground vehicles, ships, individuals for various recreation purposes, individuals for engineering purposes, and monitoring the various structures. So much are there. So we will be discussing in the point, the user point of view, about the GPS functionalities and its characteristics in the coming slides. So we will discuss about the working principles of the GPS. The configuration of the satellite constellation provides the user 5 to 8 satellites visible from any point of the earth. So then what happens? Once you are getting the signals from 5 to 8 satellites, then each satellite constantly sends the radio signals from space announcing its number and the time the signal was sent. So from each satellite you will know from which satellite you are getting the signal and the timing of the signal, the when it starts sending the signals. These informations will be sent. The distance from each satellite to the receiver is calculated by comparing the 3 signals from the 3 satellites. We will see how the distance is being calculated. It is based on a simple surveying principle called trilateration. Then the time difference. So you know the time when the satellite is starts sending the signal, and also in the receiver you know the time when the satellite signals completely reach your receiver. By knowing down the time difference, we can multiply by the speed of the light to get the distance from the satellite to the receiver. So radio waves, it is also an electromagnetic wave, which we have discussed in the last lecture in total stations. So it also travels in this at the speed of light, That means 3 to the power 10 to the power 8 per meter per second. So once you know the time difference, starting time and end time, and the velocity, we can calculate the distance. So if this is done for each satellite, the receiver sees. Suppose if your receiver sees 4 satellites, we can calculate the distance between your receiver and the satellite by using this principle. Then by knowing the distance and the location of each visible satellite, we can locate the position of the receiver using a simple surveying principle called trilateration. Theoretically, 3 satellites are sufficient to provide the receiver location. So the students who have studied engineering survey may be knowing the what you mean by trilateration. We will discuss what is trilateration. You might have at least familiar with the term called triangulation. It is also similar. So by knowing the distance and the location of each visible satellite, we can easily locate the position of the receiver, which is unknown. In trilateration is the process determining the absolute or relative location of points by measurement of the distance using the geometry of circle, sphere or triangle. So in trilateration, what you will do means, if you know the distance from the 3 known points, then using this principle, trilateration principle, using the principles of trigonometry, we can easily calculate the location of the receiver, the unknown point. This is the trilateration. Triangulation is nothing but knowing the angle from any 2 points and distance from 1 point, you can locate the unknown point. Here, angle measurements are not involved, only the distance. If you know the distance from 3 known points, we can easily locate your position. I will illustrate this with a simple example also. Working principle, as I told, it involves 2 things, satellite ranging and distance measurement. So satellite ranging means it involves identifying the satellite location, satellite to user distance, user means here where you keep the receiver, and it needs 4 satellites to determine the position. You have to keep remembering one thing. I told that theoretically 3 satellites are sufficient, but in GPS we need 4 satellites. I will tell why we need the 4 satellites also. Once you have done the satellite ranging, then is the distance measurements. In the distance measurements, the radio signal traveling at the speed of light measure the distance from satellite to user, then we can calculate the distance between satellite and the user. These are the fundamental things involved in the satellite. So generally, satellite ranging means finding the distance between the satellite and the receiver, satellite receiver. So finding the satellite distance between the satellite and the satellite receiver is called satellite ranging. That is being done. Once you have done that, then we can easily, using the principle of trilateration, we can calculate the position. So how the distances are calculated? That is using the simple Doppler principle. So you may be asking, how the GPS receiver knows where the satellites are located? So I told that for in trilateration, you need the distance from 3 known points. So how will you know the location of that point, 3 points? That is what here I am going to discuss. The GPS receiver picks up 2 kinds of coded information from satellite. One is called almanac and another one is called ephemeris. So almanac is a kind of signal which will give you the approximate orbital parameters of the satellite constellation at a given time. Ephemeris is a very precise orbital data for each satellite consisting of the health and exact location information. So normally almanac can be predicted 1-2 weeks before or 3 weeks before. So you know that, okay, what will be the approximate timing the satellite will pass this particular location, and how many number of satellites may be visible at this point of time at this location after 2 weeks or after 3 weeks. So that kind of calculations can be obtained from almanac because it is an approximate orbital parameters based on the satellite configuration constellation that we can predict. But what happens due to the various weather conditions and climatic conditions, the various forces acting on the satellite, the satellite may be deviating from its original orbit also. So that can be obtained only in the ephemeris data. That means only after the satellite after the actual pass of the satellite. So ephemeris is a very precise data. Almanac is useful mainly for preparing your survey. Suppose if you want to do a survey in a particular area, and you wanted to have an accuracy of less than centimeter accuracy for a particular survey, then you have to decide, okay, so how many satellites in that area will be visible during that day and during that point of time. Then what is the configuration, geometric configuration of the satellite positions. All these informations can be predicted in advance, and accordingly you can decide the location of the survey and timing of the survey, all these things. So that will give an idea whether with the, all these configurations, can you achieve the required accuracy. All this can be done using the almanac. It is for planning purpose. Ephemeris is one, you will be, the signal you will be getting after the actual pass of the satellite. So that will give very precise. If, even if there is a small deviation, all such informations will be available with the ephemeris data. So GPS signal characteristics, it consists of two carrier signals. One is L1 frequency. It is approximately at 1575 megahertz. It carries the navigational message, and it also carries the standard positioning system code signal such as course appreciation code. This L1 signal frequency, the L1 frequency signal will be of will have only a very rough idea. It will have the course details only. It will not give you precise details. That is why it is called the standard positioning system. The next one is L2 frequency signal. It is at the frequency of 1227 megahertz. It carries the P code. P code is for precision positioning system, and CA code is course acquisition code. You will get error of plus or minus 7 meters, 8 meters if your receiver is capable of receiving signal only at L1 frequency. If your receiver is capable of receiving signals both L1 and L2, then it can able to acquire the P code signal, which is useful for precise positioning systems. So now normally what happened, the accordingly depend upon the number of frequencies your satellite receiver, that means the GPS receiver receives, the cost of the GPS also will increase. Normally all your navigational amateur purpose GPS, your mobile and your car GPS, all these things will use only L1 frequency. That is why the cost is 5000, 6000 something. But if you want very high quality GPS which can receive both the frequencies, that is called dual frequency GPS receivers, which will give you very high accuracy, maybe in the order of centimeters or millimeters, it will cost lakhs, 3 lakhs, 2 lakhs, 7 lakhs, like this. So depend upon the number of frequencies or the channels your satellite GPS receiver receives, the cost of the GPS also will increase. Normally, these signals, L1 and L2 signals, are modulated and transmitted in the form of pseudo-random code, which is unique to each satellite vehicle. Then only you can easily identify, okay, this signal has come from this particular satellite 1 and this signal has come from particular satellite 2, like this. It is a pseudo-random code. Nowadays, recently, the signals are transmitted in L5 frequency also. It is in the range of approximately 1176 megahertz. So once you know the pseudo code, then what happens, we have to calculate the distance. The distance to the satellite is determined by measuring how long the radio signal takes to reach us from that particular satellite. So that can be obtained from the pseudo random code for each satellite vehicle. To make the measurement, we assume that both the satellite and our receiver are generating the same pseudo random code exactly at the same time. What happens, once you keep the receiver at a particular location, your receiver and a particular satellite, let us say take example of one satellite at a time, one particular satellite and the receiver will come into contact. Once they are in contact, both the satellite as well as the receiver will generate a pseudo random code. So we note down the timing, and we assume that the generation, the start of the pseudo random code, I mean generated from the satellite as well as the satellite receiver, is at the same time. By comparing how late the satellite pseudo random code appears compared to our receiver's code, we can determine how long it took to reach us. The delay in that time will give you how long it took to reach us from the satellite to the orbit, to the receiver. Multiply that travel time by the speed of light, will get the distance. Similarly, you will be calculating the distance between second satellite, third satellite and fourth satellite and any other satellites which are visible. So now we have to note down one point here. So the one point which I told is, to make measurements, we assume that both the satellite and our receiver are generating the same pseudo-random bursts at exactly the same time. So here the distance measurements mainly revolves around the time. So distance is equal to speed into time. We know that what is the speed of the light. So time travel is the time it takes a signal to travel from the satellite vehicle to the GPS receiver. So each satellite carries 4 atomic clocks. So it is made up of oscillation of cesium and rubidium atoms to measure the time. It is very, very precise atomic clocks. So the accuracy is plus or minus a second over more than 30,000 years. If it is working for 30,000 years, it may have an error of plus or minus second. You just see the accuracy. Each satellite will have such kind of rubidium clocks. Each satellite has 2 rubidium and 2 cesium clocks, which cost nearly $100,000 to $500,000. So receiver clocks will be similar to our quartz watch. Always an error between the satellite and the receiver clocks. So normally, in that, see, if you are keeping one such clock in the receiver, obviously your receiver cost will be $100,000. That is not possible, but we are getting the receivers with 1000 rupees, 5000 rupees, 1 lakh rupees, 2 lakh rupees and 3 lakh rupees. So in receiver clocks, we can have only a normal clocks. So because of the normal clocks, there will be some always an error between the satellite and the receiver clocks. That to avoid that error, or not to avoid, to remove that error, we need the fourth satellite. Otherwise, theoretically, if we know the distance from 3 known points, we can locate the unknown point. But since there will be an error from the between the satellite clock and the receiver clock, so we need one more satellite to solve for the x, y, z and delta t. That is why we need the fourth satellite. I hope you understand this. So the problem is, if you see here, we can't use the atomic clocks in the receivers. One is it is very costly, and the size of the receiver, that clock will be of the size of a big PC. Then all our receivers will be of a computer size. So that is not possible. The solution is the receiver clocks accurate over the short period of time. So we will be resetting often we will reset it, and the fourth satellite can be used to recalibrate the receiver clock. As I told that the satellite clocks are having an accuracy plus or minus second over a period of 30,000 years. So, but receiver clocks is accurate only for a short period of time, and so we need to reset it often. So to avoid that errors, then we have to use the fourth satellite. Recently, people are aware of the IRNSS. So recently our satellite also, IRNSS is the Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System. So once satellite's clock got failed, so we are not getting the proper positions. So that is why they are going to launch the 8th satellite. They are going to launch the 8th satellite very soon, because that satellite with that poor quality or poorly functional clocks, we cannot achieve the accuracy what we need. So accuracy of the clocks is very important, and we cannot have a very costly clocks at our receiver. So we need to find an alternate way. So the alternate way is having the 4th satellite, 4 or meaning more than 4. But minimum 4 is required, mainly to remove the error due to time synchronization between the satellite clock and the satellite receiver clock. Satellite receiver here is your GPS receiver. So this calculation tells you the importance of the accuracy of the clocks. Let us assume that there is a 1 microsecond error between your satellite clock and the receiver clock. If you translate that, approximately 982 feet is the error you will be obtaining in the location of the GPS receiver. You can just see here, because the speed of the light is 186,000 miles per second, and if you can convert this, then approximately it will give an error of 982 feet. You can just see 1000 feet error, approximately 350 meters error is there, just if you are having 1 microsecond. So the accuracy of the clocks is very important. That is why we need the fourth satellite to remove that errors. 4 or more satellites. If you are getting more satellites, it will be more precise. So here I am going to discuss about trial iteration principle using a simple example. I told that the trial iteration principle is you can find the location of an unknown point from knowing the distance from three known points. So let us take one example. Now somewhere you are, this example I have used when I was working in BITS Pilani. So the locations will be near to Pilani campus. So let us assume that you are standing in a particular location and you don't know what is the name of that location, and so you are asking someone and he is saying that, okay, so you are 200 kilometers away from Delhi. Now you draw a circle. So that means your location lies on this circle, anywhere on the circle, but you don't know exactly where it is. There are so many locations will be 200 kilometers away from the Delhi, but at least you identified that, okay, you are in this circumference of the circle. Next, and after some minutes, some another person is coming. So he is saying that, okay, you are located some 220 kilometers from Jaipur. Then you draw another circle with the 210 kilometer radius. Then what happened? These two circles will intersect at two different points. So now you know that you may be either this or this point, but still you don't know whether this point or this point. There are two possibilities. Now after 5 minutes, some another person is coming and he is saying that, okay, you are 55 kilometers from Junjunu. Then you draw a circle of radius 55 kilometer. Then all these three circles will intersect at only one location, and that location will be your location. So in this case, the location is Pilani. So Pilani is the place where BITS camp, BIT, Birla Institute of Technology and Science campus is located. It is 200 kilometers from Delhi, 220 kilometers from Jaipur, and 55 kilometers from Junjunu. These are some of the nearby cities. So this tells you the principle of trial iteration. Similarly, your satellites also, the receiver also finds the location of the of its position by knowing the distance from four satellites. So like this, the satellites also will, the receiver also will calculate the distance from the each satellite vehicle, and it will identify its location. Since I told there is an time synchronization error, you may get, you will not exactly get the particular one location. So you may get a group of locations. To avoid that, we need the four satellite. So this is the 2D trial iteration. If the same thing appears in the happens in the 3D sphere, 3D space, then it is called 3D trial iteration. So pseudo range observation equation. So what I will tell you means, I will tell you the, I will give you the equation, mathematical equations for the calculating the distance between the satellite vehicle and your GPS receiver. Pseudo range from the code measurements equals the time shift that is necessary to correlate the incoming code sequence with the code sequence generated in the GPS receiver multiplied by the velocity of the line. I had told that. So there will be when both the satellite and the receiver comes into contact, both will generate the pseudo code. So we will be noting down the delay in the pseudo code coming from the satellite, and that delay time will be multiplied by the velocity of the light to get the pseudo range. Range here means distance. The pseudo range equation is this one. If you see here, P subscript, I have given superscript and subscript SR. S stands for the satellite and the R stands for the distance. The PSR is the pseudo range between the satellite and the receiver. So is equal to the simple. It's equal to the square root of x to the power s minus xr square, ys minus yr square, plus zs minus zr square, plus c delta tr. If you see here, xs, ys and zs represent the location of the antenna face center of the satellite vehicle at the time of emission. So that will tell you the location of the satellite vehicle at that point of time when it generated the pseudo code. And the XR, YR and ZR represents the location of the antenna face center of the user receiver at the instant of the reception, when it receives the signal at that point, that will give you the X. C is the velocity, and delta TR is the receiver clock synchronization error. It is a constant for a particular receiver. So that error will be constant for particular receiver. Then, so that means this is constant. C is the velocity of the light. So now what happens in this case? So we need, there are, how many unknowns are there? X is known, not known, Y is not known, XR, YR and ZR. This three is yet to be calculated. That means it represents the location of the antenna face of the center of the user receiver. And then we don't know the delta TR. There are four unknowns are there. So you need naturally the four equations. The four equations comes from the four different satellites. This is for one satellite. Similarly, you will get from the another satellite, third satellite and fourth satellite. You have four equations and four unknowns. Then you can easily calculate the four unknowns, because delta TR is constant and only you need is XR, YR and ZR. XS and YS and ZS for four different satellites can be obtained. So the satellites uses a coordinate system called Earth-centered geographical coordinate systems. This is the coordinate system which is used by the satellites to locate its position. We will discuss that also briefly. Yeah. So the GPS receiver positions. The position dimensions are computed by the receiver in the Earth-centered, Earth-fixed coordinate systems. Latitude, longitude. Similarly, this is an Earth-centered, Earth-fixed coordinate system. The position in X, Y, Z is converted within the receiver to the geodetic latitude, longitude and height above the ellipsoid. So we will discuss what is ellipsoid also. This one. Then latitude and longitude are usually provided in the geodetic datum on which the GPS is based. Normally, for any defining any coordinate system, we need a reference surface. So one such reference surface is called as WGS-84 datum. It is a mathematical surface created by the gravity measurements. Based on these surfaces, only the location and the location of the GPS receivers as well as the GPS satellites are defined. GPS satellites, the same thing will be projected towards the space. That's all. Before going into the sources of error, I will just stop here to answer your questions. If you have any questions, please ask me. Then we will go to the next part. Start my question and answer session with the first question who asked. What is the difference between frequency and the carrier wave? Actually, every wave will have its wavelength as well as the frequency. The frequency tells the what is the frequency of that wave at that particular wavelength. That's all. So carrier wave, that means it is the coarse wave. There are two signals, frequencies. The signal is being moderated and sent. One is L1 and L2. L1 is, I told, it is approximately 1500 megahertz frequency. So L2 is 1100 megahertz frequency. That's all. So one has asked me, explain the working of GPS system again. So GPS system contains satellites, 24 satellites. It's not single satellite, 24 satellites orbiting in six different orbital planes. So once you have the GPS receiver at the location, so the GPS receiver will try to get in touch with the GPS signal satellites. So but we don't know what is the location of the GPS receiver. To know its location, to calculate its location, we need to know the distance between at least four satellites. Once you know the distance between the distance between the receiver to the satellites, four different satellites, then using the principle of trial iteration, we can easily calculate the location of the receiver. This is how the GPS works. The entire coordinate systems in which the GPS calculates the system, its coordinates, is based on the Earth-centered, Earth-fixed coordinate systems, whose center of origin is the center of the origin of the mass of the Earth. I hope I answered your question. So one person have asked KE cap. They have asked, could you explain about the pseudo random codes? Yeah. Pseudo random codes is nothing but it's a dummy code generated by each satellite. It will be modulated for just for transmission purposes. It will be modulated and it will be sent to the receivers. So what happens once the satellite, a particular satellite and the receiver comes into contact, then let us say there are four satellites are in contact with the receiver. Then how will you know that, okay, this signal is sent by the particular satellite, satellite 1, satellite 2, satellite 3, satellite 4. So to get that one, they have done a mechanism such that the once it is in touch, once they are in the contact, the receiver and the satellite 1, they both will start generating the random code, pseudo random code. So it is just an, it's all completely in the electronics. As a if I start keep on explaining, then I need another 1 hour lecture only for explaining the frequency, wave, all these things. So once it is generated, then each pseudo random code will be unique to the particular satellite. So that code will not be look like a pseudo random code coming from the satellite 2. But if you are not generating the pseudo random code, only if in the L1 frequency or L2 frequency, then you cannot know which one is coming from which satellite. Just for identifying the particular satellite, they are generating the pseudo random code. So one have asked me, IGCEP, they asked, what is the difference between trilateration and triangulation? Trilateration involves identifying the location of an unknown point by knowing the distance from three known points. Trilateration is opposite. Identifying the location of an unknown point by knowing the angles from two different points and distance from one point. It involves angular measurements in triangulation. In trilateration, it involves only the distance measurements. That's the basic difference. So next we will discuss about the sources of errors. So the first and foremost source of error was selective availability. It is intentional degradation of the GPS accuracy by the US Department of Defense. The accuracy, the error will be 100 meter in horizontal and 160 meter in vertical. Accounted for most of the errors in standard GPS, turned off in May 2000. Before May 2000 or until 2nd May 2000, this error was prevalent, and nowadays this error is no more. It is intentional degradation of the GPS accuracy, because earlier as I told that the GPS was mainly launched for the purpose of defense purpose. So the US government wanted to restrict the usage of the GPS by the enemy countries. So they have used to intentionally degrade the quality of the GPS signal so that its accuracy becomes very poor. And then they somehow they started when they realized the potential of the GPS for various civilian applications, they turned off this intentional degradation of the GPS accuracy. Nowadays you are not having the such kind of accuracies. This figure tells you the graphical representation of the error. So earlier, the particular GPS location, the receiver location may be some very scattered like this. Now, once it is turned off, it becomes very less, the scatter, the spread is very less. Only because of the non-availability of the intentional degradation of GPS accuracy. Okay, so they asked me again the working of GPS. See, I am just again telling the working principle of GPS. So the configuration of satellite constellation provides the user 5 to 8 satellites visible from any point on the earth. Each satellite constantly sends radio signals from space announcing its number and the time of signal when it was sent. The distance from the each satellite to the receiver is calculated by comparing the time signals. So for that purpose only I told that when how to compare the time signals, that means there will be a clock in the receiver as well as in the satellite. The clock will measure the time when the satellite sent the signal and when it is received by the receiver. By knowing the time delay, we can calculate the distance between the satellite and the receiver. The time difference is multiplied by the speed of the light to get the distance from satellite to receiver. This is done for each satellite the receiver sees. Once you know the distance from three or four unknown points or from known points, then you can easily use the trial iteration method to calculate the position of the receiver. As I told, theoretically three satellites are sufficient, but due to the error in the clock kept in the satellite and the GPS receiver, we need the fourth satellite. Suppose if the timing is not measured accurately, there will be some error in the time measurements. Mainly that is due to the poor accuracy clocks kept in our GPS receivers. So to avoid that error, we need four satellites. So yeah, someone has asked if the plotted position of an instrument station is not known, the most accurate orientation of the plane table can be achieved by. See, here we cannot orient that GPS. There are so many satellites will be there and it will keep on rotating. You cannot keep on changing your receiver position like this. So don't forget, don't mix the orientation concept with the trial iteration concept here. So I suggest you to read this trial iteration concept from the surveying, engineering surveying. I think maybe in the volume 2 will be available in any of the books like Punya and Aurora. So the best way to do ground control survey is through triangulation, because angle and distance are needed. Because distance calculations mainly, if you are using the indirect measurements to calculate the distance, there will be errors. So angles can be measured directly using theodolite or total stations. So it is preferred to use triangulation rather trial iteration for ground control surveys. Someone has asked. I hope I answered that question too. So now I will proceed for the lecture. Next is the other sources of error is geometric dilution of precision. So it tells the sensitivity of the receiver to changes in the geometric position of the satellite vehicles. Higher the DOP value, the poor the measurements. If you see here, this is the figure which tells the poor GDOP, poor geometric dilution of precision. This is where your receiver is kept, and if your satellites are exactly at this position, which you are having the poor geometric configuration of the satellites which are visible to your receiver. That is called geometric dilution of precision. And the good GDOP is shown in the bottom figure. If you see here, if the satellites are spread across like this, then you are getting good GDOP, geometric dilution of precision. So that means if the GDOP value is higher, means it is poor. That means if the dilution of the precision is very high. GDOP high means the dilution of precision is high, the precision is diluted very drastically. That means the measurement accuracy is poor. So generally these are the sum of the values. If your DDOP, that is the geometric dilution of precision, is 1 to 3 means it is very good. If it is 4 to 5 means it is good. 6 means fair, and if it is greater than 6 means it is suspect. That means you cannot trust the values given by the such satellites. Even though the 4 satellites are there or 5 satellites are there, if their geometric configuration or alignment to the receiver, if it is not good, then the accuracy also will be affected. So this, about this geometry concept, you can refer the trigonometry basics. There are other types of dilution of precisions apart from the GDOP. The GDOP is geometric dilution of precision, and TDOP, another one, is the position dilution of the precision. This is the accuracy of the measure of accuracy in the 3D position. It is also called as spherical DDOP. Another one is HDDOP, horizontal dilution of precision. It is also a measure of accuracy in the 2D position. For example, latitude and longitude. What is the accuracy in terms of horizontal coordinates, latitude and longitude? And another one is VDOP, vertical dilution of precision. What is the dilution of precision in the vertical measurements, mainly the height measurements? Then TDOP, that is the total dilution of precisions, which takes into account the TDOP is time dilution of precisions. It is measure of accuracy in the time. All should be in the, what you can say, applicable means acceptable limits. GDOP is will represents both the p dot as well as the t dot. So if the geometric dilution of precision represents the overall dilution of precision the characteristics of the satellites and the receiver. So it is the square root of geometric d dot, that is geometric dilution of precision is nothing but square root of p dot square plus the t dot square. That means it takes care of the position dilution as well as the time dilution. The other sources of errors are the clock error, as I told that is the difference between the satellite clock and the receiver clocks. That can be easily avoided by using one more satellite, that is the fourth satellite. Then another one is ionospheric delays. As I told that the GPS satellites are positioned nearly 20,000 kilometers above the Earth surface. So it has to transfer, means it has to travel the entire spectrum, ionosphere, stratosphere and atmosphere, all these things. Everywhere it will have a lot of disturbances. Then that also will affect the signal travel time. The delay of GPS signal as they pass through the layer of charged ions and free electrons known as ionosphere also will have the effect in the location calculation. Another one is multipath error. Multipath error, if you will be encountering these kind of errors in a highly densely, or you can say populated area, or you can say highly densely built up land. Simple, populated area means built up land, I am saying. It is caused by the local reflection of the GPS signal that mixed with the desired signal. So what happens, sometimes instead of the signal traveling straightly directly from the satellite to the receiver, it will go to the nearby building and from there it will be reflected to the receiver. So the total travel path has been changed. This might affect the some distance also between the satellite and the receiver. So this kind of problems will occur mainly in the densely built up land. This slide tells about the effects of different errors and their magnitude. Ionospheric errors, typically it will have plus or minus 5 meters. Troposphere, plus or minus 0.5 meters. Ephemeris error, plus or minus 2.5 meters. As I told, ephemeris means it is the precise orbital data. Even if it is in, deviated from the original position, we may hit plus or minus 2.5 meters. And satellite clock errors, multipath distortions and numerical errors. Numerical errors means there are many numerical models are used to calculate the various parameters. So that also may cause some errors. So this is the type of errors. Then next we will discuss about the types of GPS. First one is recreational grade GPS. So you will be getting an accuracy of plus or minus 15 meters. Then mapping grade GPS, you will get 1 to 5 meter accuracy. It is moderately expensive. And survey grade GPS, which will be very expensive and will get centimeter to millimeter level accuracies. Sometimes in real time, sometimes in post processing mode. I told that recreational GPS will have an error of plus or minus 15 meters. So in that case, how to reduce that errors? Even the survey grade GPS or mapping grade GPS also, I told it is having 1 to 5 meters errors. But how to reduce that errors? Yes, can we cancel out the errors and get better than 15 meter accuracy using an ordinary recreational GPS? Yes, it is possible through a correction called differential correction. We will discuss about what it is. Differential correction is a method used to reduce the effects of atmospheric errors and other sources for GPS positioning errors. Differential correction cannot correct for the multipath or the receiver error. It counteracts only the errors that are common to both reference and the roving receivers. So that means you need two receivers, not only one receiver. The differential correction means with respect to the other receiver, we will be correcting the position of the current receiver. It is a relative error correction. So the differential correction cannot correct for the multiple path or the receiver error. It only counteracts the errors that are common to the reference and the roving receivers. We will discuss what it is. It requires, in addition to your roving GPS receiver, a GPS receiver on the ground in a known location to act as a static reference point. So in differential correction, you need two receivers. One is kept statically at a known point. And another is your receiver where you want to get the accurate satellite signals. So based on the With reference to the position of the known location, we can correct the position of your unknown location. So by this way, we can reduce the errors using a normal ordinary grade GPS. So differential DGPS. So it is a method of removing the errors that affect GPS measurements. So here you will be having a base station receiver set up on a location where the coordinates are known. The error in the signal time at reference station is calculated by comparing the established coordinates and the observed coordinates. The real-time corrections transmitted to the remote receiver. What happens? This figure tells you the differential GPS positioning. So this is your base station. So here you just see here, this is the base station. So here, this base station coordinates are known. Let us say this is the base, the benchmark station whose coordinates are known by a very accurate survey. Latitude, longitudes are known now. Now your receiver is this one. That is called as rover. In differential GPS system, you need two GPS receivers. One is base receiver and another one is the rover. Now this rover receiver is an ordinary mapping grade receiver. Now with that, you wanted to achieve the better accuracies. So we get, for that, we will be correcting the errors caused due to the satellites and ionosphere and atmosphere, all these things with respect to the base station's coordinates. So now we know that base station coordinates are well correctly established, and we need to find the coordinates of your rover. So for this purpose, you have to observe the satellites at the same time. So the distance between the base station and the rover should be restricted within 100 kilometers or 50 to 60 kilometers is the ideal range. It is assumed that both the base as well as the receiver station receives signals from the same set of satellites. That means if you are there are 24 satellites, I told, if you are receiving signals from satellite 1, 2, 3, 4 at the rover, the same satellite's signal should be received by the base station also. Then only the errors will be common. That is one assumption. So that is why the distance between the base station and the rover will be restricted to 50 to 60 kilometers. One. Then, whatever the errors caused by the ionosphere, troposphere, atmosphere, all these things, in these first four satellites at the receiver, at the rover station, will be applicable to the base station also. So based on that, you will calculate the coordinates. Based on the uncorrected message, you will calculate the coordinates of the base station. And you know what is the actual coordinates of the base station surveyed. Then you can calculate the difference in the coordinates. That can be translated into the time error of the satellite signals. So then that error message can be transmitted through a radio signal from the base station to the receiver, the rover station, in real time. Then the rover station will take into that correction messages and it will give you the corrected position. So there are two possibilities. This DGPS can be corrected, can be performed in RTK mode, in real time mode, as well as otherwise in post processing mode. Suppose if there is no radio connection between your base station and the receiver, rover station, then all these informations will be stored in your GPS receiver and it can be corrected, the position of the receiver can be corrected once you come back to the office. That is called PPK mode. And another one, if there is a radio signal connection between the base station and the receiver, both can be, the correction can be done on real-time basis. So the real-time correction is transmitted to the receiver with a single frequency. Suppose if your receiver is a single frequency receiver, you can get an accuracy of 1 to 5 meters just by using additional base station receiver. If it is a dual frequency receiver, so you can get sub-meter accuracy without increasing the cost of the receiver. Just by adding one more receiver and the base station, so you can achieve the accuracy of sub-meter level using the DGPS in real-time mode. There are other ways we can also improve the GPS accuracy. We can augment the GPS accuracy. GPS augmentation systems are being developed to aid in augmentation of the accuracy, integrity and availability or other improvements with GPS based questioning. Augmentation means improvement. The improvement of the accuracy, integrity and availability can be achieved by the following types of systems. One is satellite based augmentation systems called as SBAS, and another one is ground based augmentation systems. So there are some satellite based augmentation systems called WAS, Wide Area Augmentation System, EGNOS and Gagan. Gagan is the satellite based augmentation system over across Indian region. We will see what it is. SBAS is a wide area or regional augmentation system that provides the users additional satellite based broadcast message. Broadcast message means ephemeris data. More navigation the satellite messages, that means the satellites more accurate information about the satellite's orbit informations. So what happens, so these satellites, the SBAS is for a particular region only. It is currently it is available for USA region and most part of the US. So what they do means they will add another set of satellites and ground antennas, ground monitoring stations, where they will track all these GPS satellites and it will be tracked, and if there is any deviation it will be monitored and then it will be sent to the master station, and then they will correct it, and then again the corrected message will be sent to the users. That means the users who are having the GPS receivers. The only thing is the receiver should be capable of receiving the signals from VAS enabled sensor satellites. That means again the cost will increase. Normal GPS receiver will not have that functionality to receive the signals from SBAS system. Normally it should have a separate provision. So this figure tells the architecture of the SBAS system, and this is about the wide area augmentation systems across the US. It provides a system of satellites and ground stations that provide GPS signal correction. As I told, it will have the ground stations also. Across US there are 25 ground reference stations. The master stations create the GPS correction message. The corrected differential message broadcast to the geostationary satellite to the receivers. That means the communication through the communication satellites. Through this you will get 5 times the accuracy. So it requires only a VAS enabled GPS. Again the cost will increase, and these facilities will be available only across the USA. Though if you purchase a VAS enabled GPS in India, you cannot utilize that advantage because across India there is no VAS enabled system available. But currently the Indian government also developed one such system called Gagan. So Gagan is nothing but GPS aided geo augmented navigation, or GPS and geo augmented navigation system. Gagan is an implementation of a regional satellite based augmentation system, SBAS, by Indian government. It is a system to improve the accuracy of the GNSS receiver by providing reference signal. The system here contains 8 reference stations: Delhi, Guwahati, Kolkata, Ahmedabad, Trivandrum, Bangalore, Jammu and Port Blair, and a master control station at Bangalore. So these 8 stations will track whenever the GPS across the flows across orbits across the Indian boundary, and then they will do the corrections of the navigation signals, and the corrected signals will be sent to the receiver user through the geostationary satellites like GSAT-8 and GSAT-10. Yeah, so another important aspect in knowing the GPS survey is you should worry about the datums. As I told that the position of your receiver will be calculated by knowing the position of the 4 satellites. So what are the coordinate systems, how the position of the satellites are known, what are the coordinate system they are using, what datum they are using, what datum the GPS gives you the position, everything will be very important. Knowing those things will be very important. The position, the coordinate system used in the GPS, both in the space as well as on the earth, is based on the earth center, earth fixed coordinate system. Anyway, I'm not going into detail about that. Then they use a datum, a mathematical surface based on which the coordinates are defined. There are many datums are available. There are local datums, there are global datums, many are available. So GPSS uses one such datum called WGS 1984. Suppose if you are using different datums, obviously there will be error in the positions also will appear, will occur. So this one is the actual topography, our actual gear, and the red line is the geoid. Geoid is nothing but an first approximation of the actual shape of the earth. It is because actual shape of the earth is very irregular, so we cannot do any measurements properly. So we need an approximation. The first approximation, the first and best approximate shape of the earth is geoid. Geoid is nothing but the surfaces of equal gravity potential. Surface created by a equal gravity potential of particular magnitude. Geoid. But this surface in generally pass through the mean sea level across different countries. But this surface is also irregular because the gravity potential across the earth is not uniform because of the composition of the, because of the varied composition of the complex composition of the earth's surface. So the geoid is also not a smooth surface. So making calculations on geoid is also very difficult. Then the scientists have developed a mathematical surface called ellipsoid. It is called as the, represented in the green color. So there are many such ellipsoids are available, hundreds of ellipsoids are available. So the orientation of the ellipsoid and origin of the ellipsoid defines a datum. Datum is nothing but the orientation and the origin of the ellipsoid will define a datum. So WGS 1984 uses an ellipsoid called WGS 1984 ellipsoid. But its origin is the center of the mass of the Earth's gravity. Based on that datum, you can define the coordinate systems. So now we just see here, this is also called as ellipsoid. So normally if you keep a GPS, it will give you a height by default. That height is from this green line, that is called as H, that is the ellipsoidal height. And if you want to know the height from the mean sea level, we need to convert the ellipsoidal height into mean sea level height, that is orthometric height. So normally if you go to a railway station, in most of the railway stations you might have seen that there are different platforms, the height of that location is 100 meters above MSL. If you keep a GPS there and if you observe the elevation, both the elevations will not match. And you may think that our GPS is giving wrong elevation. No. GPS also correct and that elevation is also correct because that is properly surveyed. The only difference is GPS gives the height from the ellipsoidal height, ellipsoidal surface, the mathematical surface, and that height which is given in the railway stations will be the orthometric heights, that is from the red line. So we need to know the geoidal undulation, that is called N. What is the height difference between the geoidal surface and the ellipsoidal surface? Once you know this, then we can calculate the orthometric height from the GPS also. So when you are using GPS, you have to be very careful. You have to be very careful and click an option that, okay, display the heights in the orthometric heights. Display the heights from the mean sea level. Once you click that option, the GPS will be able to show the heights in the mean sea level. That height will be comparable with the height which you have seen in the railway stations because both are orthometric heights. As I told that the geoid passes through the mean sea level, the height measured from that surface is also called as orthometric heights. That geoid surface is developed based on the gravimetric measurements from satellites. There are many satellites are available whose main purpose is to measure the gravity potential across the earth, and based on the gravity potential they develop the geoid. In every GPS receiver, the geoid surface heights have been coded into the microprocessor. So once you know the latitude longitude on the ellipsoid, then you can easily calculate what is the undulation between the geoidal surface and the ellipsoidal surface, that is N. So if you keep your GPS here, then the N is calculated based on the geoid which is coded into the microprocessor of the receiver. Then you can easily calculate H minus N or H plus N to calculate the orthometric heights. So whenever you are using GPS, please ensure that the height is displayed in the MSL when you want to compare the heights available in the railway stations or any other benchmarks across India. Otherwise, you will be wrongly creating the measuring the heights. So with this, I just covered some basics of the GPS survey. Next, we will see about the applications. Application is positioning, determining the basic position, navigation, tracking, mapping. You can create the maps by just by holding the GPS receiver, and if you trace along the boundary, you will get the GPS using a mapping grade GPS. Tracking, movement of the people and the movement of vehicles. Navigation, getting from one location to another location, you can use GPS. This which most of you are might have familiar about the application of GPS in navigation. And for positioning, other things is private and recreation purpose, for using for hiking, climbing, mountaineering, mapping, survey and geology. Agriculture, as I told, GPS can be also used for precision agriculture, aviation and maritime. So now let us discuss about the GPS surveying methods. Based on the number of receivers, the GPS surveying can be divided into single point positioning and relative positioning. Single point positioning means you will be using only one receiver and you will note down the location. In that case, there will be some errors will be there. To reduce that errors from the single point positioning, you can use two different positions, GPS, that through DGPS method. One will be act as a base and another will act as a rover. That is called relative positioning. And another one is based on the movement of the receiver. It is static positioning and kinematic positioning. If your receiver is kept ideal for a particular location for more than 10 minutes or 5 minutes statically, then it is called static positioning. If the receiver is also keep on moving, then it is called kinematic positioning. Then based on the GPS data processing, it is real-time surveying and post-process surveying. The post-process surveying will give the maximum accuracy possible. So once you have the data with the GPS, you can easily integrate that with the any GIS softwares, and you can prepare the maps very easily. This is how you can integrate the GPS data. So these are some of the handheld GPS and their cost. So normally the Garmin eTrex is a simple GPS whose cost is just 4500 rupees. And there is another Garmin GPS, Garmin 1212, which is cost is 6000 rupees. And the Trimble Geo XS, it is a mapping grade handheld GPS. Its cost is 4 lakhs. The accuracy will be in centimeters. If you do the GPS survey using the Trimble Geo XS, you can get millimeter accuracies. And there is some wrist watches are also available, which is from Casino. It is cost approximately 2 lakhs. So if you go back to my first slide, I told that GPS is a part of global navigation satellite systems. So there are other such GNSS systems are available. Those are, one is GLONASS. It is launched by Russia. After a decade gap, now it is fully operational since September 2010. And Galileo, it is an GNSS system launched by the European Union. And BeiDou, it's a China-based satellite which is going to be fully operational by 2020. And the last one is IRNSS, Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System. It is to be fully operational by end of 2017. These are some of the satellite navigation systems which are part of GNSS. So these are some of the useful websites of GPS from where you can learn more about the GPS. And with this, I'll close this session. Thank you all. So now you can start asking me questions. Yeah, the question from DGA is, which type of GPS is used in modern cars? So in all the modern cars, they use the simple single frequency GPS, navigational recreational GPS. That is called the single frequency GPS or with L1 frequency, which can get only signals of a CA code, course acquisition code, because it is very cheap, 6,000-7,000 rupees cost. So they will get an accuracy of plus or minus 5 meters to 7-6 meters. What are the uses of GPS? Yeah, it's very simple. It has a lot of users in civil engineering applications. For example, to find the location of a particular point, in older days, you have to do the triangulation, trilateration, all this kind of surveying techniques, and you have to start from a benchmark locations, and then you have to establish the coordinates. Now, with the help of GPS, just go and take your GPS and keep the receiver there and observe for half an hour or 1 hour, you will get the location. It becomes very simple. And another thing, if you want to prepare the map of your study area, there are different modes of data collection: point mode, line mode, and polygon mode. Suppose if you want to prepare the road map of Mumbai city, I just simply want to switch on the GPS in line mode, and I have to walk along the roads which I wanted to map. At the end of the survey, I will be getting the map of all the roads. Simple. So that can be achieved using mapping grade GPS. And also I can do the crustal movement studies. Suppose if I want to know what is the rate of movement of earth crust, that also can be studied using GPS, but you need very accurate GPS system for that. You have to do lot of corrections. You have to account for the ionospheric corrections, tropospheric corrections, mathematical errors, and multipath errors. All these corrections has to be done. That is need to be done. Then another one is also it is used for navigation purpose. If you want to move from one location to another location, you can use the GPS. And another important application in civil engineering is GPSs. You can also use this for dam deformation studies also. So if you keep the GPS on the dam wall, the spill veneer just above the spillways there, and if you monitoring the movement of the spillway, means when there is no water, when there is half filled water in the dam, and when it is fully dam occupied by water, there will be some deformation will be there on the spillway due to the pressure, etc. And if your GPS is very accurate, we can also move whether that deformation is within the permissible limits or not. There are so many applications are there. Yeah, so second question is, what is exactly the clock error? Yeah, actually, as I told that the time measurement is the very important thing in the GPS. The satellite also will, once the satellite and the your receiver comes into contact, both will generate the pseudo random code immediately. When both are in contact, immediately they will start generating. Then you will measure the distance, you have to measure the time taken for this signal coming from the satellite. So once both are in contact, both will generate the signal. Then what happens, the satellite signal will take some time to reach the receiver. The time delay between the satellite wave, signal wave, and the your receiver clock wave will be calculated. Then the time delay will be used to calculate the distance. If there is a small 1 microsecond error in the generation of the wave in the receiver, that will cause approximately 1000 feet error in the position that I told in the one slide. Another question is, what is standard positioning service? Standard positioning service means, SPS means, the receivers will receive only the L1 signal. It is a single frequency receivers. It cannot get the L2 frequency signals. It cannot get the P code signal. It will receive only the CA code receiver. The accuracy will be less in that case. Yeah. One student have asked, what is GPS rover? They ask rollover. It is not rollover. It is rover. So when you are using a DGPS system, you need two receivers. One is called base and another one is rover. The base receiver will be kept at a location whose position is accurately calculated. Then another receiver will be kept on moving to the locations for which you want to calculate the coordinates. That is called rover. The base will be constant and the rover will be keep on moving at different locations where you need to calculate the location. The distance between the base and the rover should be maintained within 50 to 60 kilometers, because it is assumed that both base receiver as well as the rover receiver receive signals from the same satellites. That means the errors caused in the coordinates kept at the calculated by the base station as well as the base station receiver as well as the rover receiver is caused by the same factors. So actually it is nothing specific, different equipment. Both the receivers are same. If we have two receivers, both receivers are same. One will be kept at the base to monitor the error coordinates at the base, and based on the errors at the base coordinates, it will be transmitted. The error signal, the correction message will be transmitted to the receiver rover, either in real time or it can be done in post also. That's all. Rover is the one which will be keep on moving, whose position has to be calculated. Someone has asked, what is the use of trilateration method? Trilateration method is the basic thing from which you will calculate the location of the known unknown point. Trilateration means you will be calculating, knowing the distance from the three known points. Based on the distance from three known points, you can calculate the location of the unknown point. That is called trilateration. So here also you are using three satellites. Minimum theoretically three. Since there is an error in the clock synchronization, we need four satellites. So that is the basic principle. So thank you all for attending this QEEE lectures for last three sessions, where I have covered overview of plane table surveying and overview of total stations and some brief overview of global positioning system today. I hope you all enjoyed these lectures, and I hope that it might be beneficial to you. If you have any queries, you can contact me through my email. I'll be very happy to answer your queries, and I wish you all the best. Yeah, so before going, there is a question from Jane to you. What is the difference between single frequency and dual frequency? If your receiver is able to receive the signals from CA code L1 frequency as well as from L2 frequency, then it is dual frequency receiver. If the receiver is able to receive only one frequency of signal, then it is called single frequency receiver. Obviously, the dual frequency receiver will give more accurate results and its cost is higher than the single frequency receiver. Yeah, I think I have answered all the questions. So, see you all. All the best. Thank you.